to become more sustainable across all areas of my life. I'm going to look at the changing production of meat, whether I can power my own commute, and what can I do inside my own home to lower my carbon footprint. Maybe the future lies in magically lit summer fruit and fish poo salad. Who'd have thought?
It's January, so it's winter here in Northern Europe, and it's absolutely freezing, which is the perfect time to talk about strawberries. The thing is, strawberry production requires a warm environment. This definitely didn't grow out here. So where did it grow?
The benefit of LED lighting is that researchers like Lisanne can control the light spectrum and develop their own light recipes to determine which colours the plants best respond to. Red light is the most efficient for photosynthesis, and blue light is necessary for good plant development in the absence of natural light. And it's this recipe of blue and red which gives us the pink glow. Here they've also added a bit of white light into the mix, but that's not for the plants. It's to make the working environment more comfortable for humans.
It is bright pink in here. Why? Why is everything growing under the lights?
We can make every combination of light colors we want. The plant is most efficient with red light, and also red light is most efficient to make from electricity. So in that case we can go to a more sustainable growing system. And there's also a little bit of blue light inside this light spectrum. And that also has to do with the plant physiology, because without daylight the plant needs a bit of blue light.
Why is this better than other types of grow lamps?
Because we can focus and we can make the best spectrum, because we can choose which light we want to go have in. We can let the plant grow most efficient, so we can choose what the crop needs. The main advantage, if we look to sustainability, is that LED light needs less energy for making the same amount of light from which the plant can grow. Because we have not the heat production, we have light and climate more independent of each other.
When you grow the plants under lights like this, do they look or taste any different?
Yeah, at this moment we see that the crop reacts sometimes a bit different. We see not a direct influence on the taste. We sometimes see effects on the leaves and the leaf color. And we also can sometimes take an advance on that.
What do you think of the future of LED lights?
Yeah, from my opinion, LED light will be the future for greenhouse horticulture and also, of course, for vertical farming. LED light will be the main source for grow light in greenhouse horticulture. We are focusing on measuring more and more and more, because there is really a lot of data.
Yeah.
In the future, we look to also grow more on data instead of based on growing on the human eye.
So, is this the future of farming, or are there other methods out there yet to be explored?
Here's a place that's doing things a little differently. Welcome to the world of aquaponics in Brighton, UK. Inside, there are lots of fish and lots of fish poo that apparently are making for some pretty tasty salad options. So this is an aquaponics system.
Yeah.
Quite simply, what does that mean?
So we can grow any kind of freshwater fish or shellfish. So it's aquaculture and hydroponics combined. So most plants will also grow. But basically we feed the fish, and then the fish waste feeds the plants, and the plants clean the water for the fish. So you get that constant cycle of water and nutrients.
So the fish poo is feeding the plants, is that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, basically they give off ammonia as their main waste product. And then that gets converted by bacteria into nitrates, which is the nitrogen cycle. And then plants take that out of the water.
That water is going through a filter system?
Yeah, it goes through a biological filter and then goes to the plants.
And that is turning the ammonia into nitrates,
yep.
And then that's feeding the plants at the top of the system?
Yes.
So it just keeps going round and round
yes.
and round?
Yeah, we never dump the water.
All of the plants that are being used in the system, they are completely soilless?
Yeah, there's no soil in here.
So the roots are all just hanging directly into the water?
Some of them hang directly into water, others are in beds where the water goes up and then soaks the root and then they drain away again. Mm-hmm. Some of them get sprayed with water, others the water literally just runs underneath the roots.
Can you see this working on a much larger scale?
It already does. Yeah. Commercially, around the world, this is used quite large. There's huge farms, acres and acres of ponds with, and most rice, in fact, is grown in a similar way. Paddy fields have fish in them all around the edges, and then that water gets flooded through.
Are there any benefits to growing the plants soillessly?
Several. Probably one of the most relevant is the speed of growth.
Really?
Because the nutrients are being delivered direct to the root zone of the plants, the plants don't need to expend so much energy putting out root growth, so it goes into foliar growth or flowering. The energy is basically going straight into the growth of the plant rather than so much into the root.
So it's more efficient?
Efficient. Things grow about twice as fast as growing in the ground.
The plants, they're getting their food from the nitrates, from the fish. But what are you feeding the fish?
So, different things. We feed the tilapia, you can feed them on leftovers out of harvesting. So you can feed them on the green growth or you can feed them algae.
So you've picked your plants, you've taken what you need, any leftover salad leaves.
Pop it in the
just throw it straight in the water.
Things like trout, which require more protein, we give them a commercial pellet at the moment, but we're going to research to make fish food more sustainable, because at the moment that's the one element that we think is a little bit lacking.
Is that because that's the one thing you're having to purchase in?
Yeah, we're purchasing in, but it also includes sea fish and stuff in there. We try to get the most sustainable ones we can.
Okay.
But we're going to develop more feeds which are going to be also will derive nutrients for the plants in a more natural way as well.
Mm-hmm. At the moment the system's got fish and plants. Could we throw anything else in the mix?
Shellfish.
What would be the benefit of shellfish?
They're filter feeders, so they clean the water and they make it crystal clear. And we haven't tried it yet, but you might be able to throw pearls.
Pearls.
Why not try freshwater pearls? I mean, you know, they've been done before. try growing them at home.
From pink strawberries and fish waste salad to the Centre for Alternative Technology in Wales, I'm off to find out how they're implementing simple solutions that not only help them with food growth, but also manage their waste.
It's chilly and it's wet, but inside we're dry, and apparently these are warm. And what is this?
Well, they will be. This is a hotbed, so it's a sort of low-tech solution. We've got a cafe here on site, so the kitchen obviously produces quite a bit of food waste, although they try to keep that minimal, but we compost all the waste from the cafe, and this is something that we do in about January, and then we put them away in June, and basically we do that to grow all our food plants and our annual bedding plants.
A byproduct of that decomposition is heat.
That's right.
And why is that a good thing?
The heat just happens naturally anyway, as the composting occurs, and so we're using these cages to try and capture the heat. When we sow our vegetables and our annual flowers, they go right on top of the straw and the heat just naturally percolates through, and that means that you need heat to germinate seeds and you need heat to keep the frost off plants. We're just using a natural process to create our heat, whereas we're not using electricity or creating
No, so you're completely cutting out the need for that.
This is off-grid very low-tech off-grid solution.
And this genuinely produces enough heat to start that germination process for you, even in the coldest winter months in Wales.
Yes, you have to feed it regularly. So you have to, you know, the lasagna will grow taller as the months go by.
I've only explored a handful of options, but it seems that when it comes to the future of food production, our sustainable solutions don't just lie in high-tech research facilities that are maximising growth, but also in championing simple systems that not only help us to produce food, but also manage and make the most of our waste. To find out more about how to live sustainably, you can watch the rest of the videos in this series, and don't forget to subscribe.